Okay, I think I can start now. So, good afternoon, everybody. So, in the last three lectures, I have been explaining the interrupts, the concept, the idea of interrupts. Is that okay? So, simply, what I can tell you is, number one, we have different sources of interrupts. We have different sources. In this chapter, I'm going to explain two. In next chapter, I'm going to explain some interrupters. In the future, you may learn more and more interrupts. All of them, the way we can program all of them, almost the same. Okay. So, but I really want you to understand the following. So try to pay attention to what I'm going to explain right now because it's very, very, very important. Is that okay? So number one, there are different sources of interrupters. Number two, you should learn. Not all the interrupters have external pin, not all of them. Okay. Also, you should understand for every interrupt, there is some hardware circuit to support or to do the work or to do most of the work. You got what I'm saying? And you should under this is the most critical part. You should understand that. As I said in the very beginning, I told you interrupters are very important. You cannot make big application without interrupters. But also, you should understand the reason why. Why? Because of interrupters, I can make big application. Simply, the reason is because the hardware CPU does not need to do all the work by itself. You got what I'm saying? The hardware is going to support the CPU. Okay? Because of that, as I told you, for example, here, if you have a CPU here, and this is a microcontroller, for example, last time I explained what we call external interrupts. So the idea of the external interrupts is that every time there is a falling edge here or rising edge or whatever, every time there is something on the pin here, I want to trigger interrupts. Okay? This one can come from user, as we are going to do tomorrow. It can come from a sensor, whatever is the source. So every time there is something here, I need to trigger interrupt and execute subroutine related to this event. Okay. And and this is the most important point. The CPU does not need to check. Are you one? No. Are you one? Is there is a falling edge? No. Is there? No. There is some circuit. There is some circuit here. Some circuit is going to monitor. There is some circuit, hardware circuit is going to monitor the pin. And once there is interrupt, you are going to interrupt me. That's what you should understand. So the CPU is not going to do the monitoring by itself. I'm going to ask assistant. It's like hardware is going to assist me. That's how we can make big programs. Okay. Today, also, I'm going to explain system timer. System timer is used if you wanna make periodic interrupts. Okay, so for example, I wanna make interrupt every certain time, every 1 second. Every 1 second, I wanna trigger interrupt. That means what this means? It means I have a subroutine. This subroutine is gonna be executed every 1 second. Certain time you can control this time. You can configure this time. So every 1 second, I wanna execute the subroutine. Is that okay? So again. The question is that who's going to count for 1 second? Who's going to count in chapter three? Because we didn't use interrupts in chapter three, I had to make a function to this function is going to run by the CPU to count for 1 second. So the CPU has to count for 1 second. However, this is the beauty of interrupts. Very important to understand what I'm saying here. The beauty of interrupts is there is some hardware circuit timer. I just CPU is going to tell the timer, please interrupt me every 1 second. Please interrupt me every 2 seconds. Please interrupt me every half a second. That's it. And then the timer is going to count, as I'm going to explain today in details, the timer is going to count for 1 second. And every 1 second is going to tell me, 1 second is right now. Then after 1 second, it's going to notify me. There is 1 second and so on. So who did the work? Who counted for 1 second? The external circuit. Oh, you got what I'm saying? Again, same thing. For example, if you have something like analog to digital convert, maybe you are not going to have time in this course to teach analog to digital converter, but it's exactly same thing. So here, analog to digital converter, there is one pin here. This pin has some analog signal, and then this one has to convert it to digital. Okay. You know, this conversion takes some time. So the CPU does not need to go check, are you done? No. Are you done? No. Are you done? No. So what can happen here, when the analog to digital circuit, when it is done, it can notify the CPU, I am done. Come right now to take the value from me. You understand what I'm saying? So number one, analog to digital, here the CPU is not gonna check anything, just when it is done, it's gonna notify. Same thing, you can have something like serial communication circuit here. You have something like serial communication here to send some data serial, okay? Or receive some data serial. Same thing, what happens here, this circuit is gonna take care, this hardware component is gonna take care of the transmission and the reception, okay? And then after it receives some data, it's gonna just attend the, interrupt the CPU. CPU, I received a byte, please come and take it. You got what I'm saying? So CPU does not need to keep it checking. Okay, same thing, if CPU wanna send some data, I have, there is a buffer here. Before I write something, I have to make sure the buffer is empty. And again, serial communication is slower than the CPU, slower. So what's gonna happen? I'm gonna send a certain data to the buffer. And then when the serial communication is done, it's gonna notify me, I am done. Come and give me another byte. Okay, guys, I think I spent a lot of time to convince you or to understand the concept, because sometimes it's hard to understand the concept and you understand why interrupters are very important. You got what I'm saying? Any question in what I said here? So last time I explained external interrupters, and today I'm gonna explain how can you generate periodic interrupters. And this one does not need external pin. So this is something internal, there is no external pin. We have a timer here, this timer and CPU, it's internal. So the CPU, the timer is gonna trigger interrupters every some time out, okay? But before I go there, I just wanna go quickly again. Yes, we use several registers here. Yes, it looks some kind, the configuration looks complicated, but it is not, by the way. Why? Simply because every time you wanna use, for example, external interrupters, okay, you have to use this code, okay? Maybe you need to do some modifications, for example, simple modification. For example, here I'm using BA5. If you wanna use something else, so if exactly it's the same code you have to use, but you have to just do some changes as I'm gonna explain, and as gonna be in the quiz tomorrow, okay? Also, so you have to do everything I'm doing here, but maybe you have to consider if you are, number one, which pin you are using, which line you are using. That's it, you got what I'm saying? And then once you do that, so it's almost the same. So once you learn it one time how to do it, you can just, you have a subroutine here. Every time there is an event here on the pin, so this subroutine is executed. So I'm gonna just, because of tomorrow's quiz, for example, here, as I told you last time, I explained last time, but I wanna go through it quickly. As I said last time, the first thing here, because I'm gonna use BA5 here in this example, I wanna use BA5 as a pin. So I'm gonna use PA5 as external pin, okay? So this is the pin that is gonna capture interrupts, okay? So you have to configure this pin input. You have to do that. So here I almost use the same code we used before to configure a pin as input, the same code, okay? Maybe there is, as I said, there is maybe something minor here. What I did here, I just connected a external resistor, okay? Actually, in our case, you don't need it, because there is already external resistance. You don't need internal one, but just I lift it just in case, because this pin should not be flowed at any time. It should not be flowed. You got what I'm saying? So if there is nothing here from the external circuit, there is no 0 volt or 5 volt. So if I connect the internal circuit, internal resistor this way, so this one is gonna put 0 volt. You got what I'm saying? But anyway, it's not gonna hurt. Yes, in our case, we have already one external here. If you add another one, it's not gonna hurt. Or you can delete it, whatever you wanna do. It's not a big deal. Okay, anyway. So what I'm saying is that if I wanna program a different one, for example, in port A. So all what you have to do, for example, port A 10, for example, all what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna just change this one, make it 10. I'm gonna change this one to make it 10. I'm going to change this one to make it 10, change this one to make it 10. Very trivial, very easy, okay? One more thing, this is for port A. What about if it is port B? Everything is the same, but you here you have to do the configuration for port B instead of A. Here you have to use B instead of A, B instead of A, and so on. So I'm going to leave this one as a rest for you, but it should be very easy, okay? Here, as I told you before, you have, as I told you before, here, every line, every line here, for example, line zero here, or external interrupt number zero, it can be connected to BA0 or PB0, only one of them, okay? At the time should be one of them. And explain last time, how can we do that? Always, regardless of what number you have to use this one all the time. You have to use this one. You don't change it, because this one actually, because the controller that is responsible to connect the line to BA0 or PBB0 is actually, you have to enable it using this one. So this one to enable the control. So regardless of what number, what line you are programming, you have to use this one. Is that okay? Number two, there is this register here. This register here, there are 4 bits. You have to write 4 bits here in order to connect here. In order to connect, for example, if this line zero, are you going to connect it to A or B? So how can you do this one? So if you want to do this one, you have to go back to the slides. I think it was very easy to understand. Yeah, it's very easy to understand here from the slide. So in tomorrow, if I tell you need to do external 10, so you have to write it here, okay? So you have to use this one instead of this one, okay? And also you have to write it here. So I already give you one example for this one, but for sure you can do it for this one or this one or this one or this one, okay? Just you need to change this one, and you need to change which bits. So here in this case, for example, if I want to program this one, so I have to put zeros here, and then I have to put here, either keep it zero, I have to keep it zero of port A. So as you see here, you have two instructions you can use. So again, I think all what you have to do, instead of doing this one, you can do, but for sure you need to use different features. Is that okay? Very easy. Yes, sure.
I wanted to ask about yesterday when you were talking about clearing
talk about what?
When you were talking about clearing the bits from the ports and like where to put the apps, you just put it like according to where the ports are. I was going to put it on. When you talk about clearing.
Which one you are talking about? This one here? This register, or you are talking about something else?
On your page 71.
Yeah, here, which one? Here, this part?
Clearing the 4 bits.
Yeah, here, clearing the 4 bits, yes. So what's your question?
So, did I remember you were talking about how you have to put the head?
Yes. So for example, you already know how to clear. Is that okay? You have to use AND. So here I have to use AND for sure. If I want to clear this one, so I have to put F here and then put zeros here. Is that okay? Okay. And if you want to clear this one, that's why I have to put F here, zero, zero here. Okay. That's exactly what I did. So look how I made it this way. Okay. Because I want to clear this 4. But if I want to clear this 4, so it's going to be F, zero, zero, zero. You got what I'm saying? Is that your question? Yeah. So the way I did it is, for example, if I want to program this one, for example, number one, I have to clear it. Okay. Number two, if you want to make it port A, you are done. You are done. You don't need to do anything else. If you want to connect it to port B, so after you clear everything, you have to set. You have to set this bit. That's okay. Yeah. So that's why I made it in 2 steps. Here to set 1 bit, here to clear the 4 bits. Okay. Again, also, I told you last time, you have two registers. One, if you want to capture only rising, or you want to capture only falling, or you want to capture both, as I explained last time. Okay. So again, if you want to capture here in this example, I want to capture only rising. Okay. So that's why I'm gonna change this register. Okay. If I give you tomorrow, for example, capture rising and falling, so you have to use the other register I explained to you before, and also you have to use the number here. For example, here, this one for line 5, if it is line 10, I would put 10 here. That's it, very easy. So the same register, if you wanna program a different line, same. So you have to use the same register. I'm not gonna change the register, but just I'm gonna change the number here. That's it, very easy, okay? Also here, I accept link here for this one. What you have to do here for the register for here, we have one bit here to enable, one bit here for enable. And this bit, actually, this number is a little bit tricky. So this number here, number 7, this is not the bit number. This is not the bin number. So for example, if you are programming bin number 10, no. How you came up with this number 7? Because this may be a little bit tricky. You got what I'm saying? Because everything you can see 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, because we are programming line number 5. But here you are using 7. So how you came up with this 7? 7, I'm going to tell you how. So this is actually the interrupt number. Okay, so what you have to put here is the interrupt number. So if you go back here, as I explained last time, yeah. So if you go here, for example, if I tell you tomorrow, you have to program either line 0 or line 1. So you have to use number 5 here. Is that okay? Because this is the interrupt number for 0 or 1. If you want to use it for 2 or 3, so you have to use number 6 here. In this example, from 4 until 15, so any line between 4 and 15, you have to use number 7 here. You got what I'm saying? That's very easy. So you have to get it from here. Anyway, so this number. The last thing here, this is for this bit. I told you last time, there are 2 bits. You have to enable 2 bits. One bit in any VIC controller. The other bit is going to be in the peripheral itself. So the way they made it, as I told you, they put actually two. Let me go back. Yeah. For enable, yeah, they actually put two bits. Where I put it? Yeah. At the peripheral itself. So what they do actually here is that there is one enable bit here, okay, and one enable bit in the peripheral itself. Is that okay? So you need to enable this one. So that's it. So this is the initialization. So here, because this is line number 5, you have to put here 5. If it is line number 7, I would put 7 here. If it is line number 10, I would put 10 here. Very easy. Okay. So now in the interrupt subroutine, number 1, you have to use certain names. You have to use certain names. I told you, because these names, their addresses are stored in memory by the project. Okay. So you have to use certain names. And I told you this one, lines 4 to 15 are going to share, the same subroutine. So this subroutine is going to be executed if I have interrupt number 4 or interrupt from line number 5 or 6 until 15. If you are using all of them, for sure, if you are using all of them, any interrupt here, this one is going to be executed. Okay, here, that is why here because we have only one interrupt number 5. I didn't care to check why this subroutine is called. Is this subroutine is called because of interrupt 5 or 6 or 7 or 8 or 4? I didn't care, right? Because we have only one interrupt. But in general, or it's going to be much better for sure if you use something like that. So you have a binding register. So in binding register, as I told you before, this is hand. Always remember when you raise your hand. Okay. So every device, every line has one bit here. Simply, once you come here, you have to check. You have to see which one is one. For example, here I'm gonna check bit number 5. If bit number 5 does not equal 0, that means bit number 5 is 1. So in this case. The subroutine is interrupted or is called because of line number 5. You get what I'm saying? So if it is a different number, for example, line number 10, I would put here 10. That's it. Very simple. Okay. Also, I made this one very clear. I'm going to show you hopefully video today. By the end of today, I'm going to show you a very interesting video just in case. And I want you to make mistakes because we learn from mistakes, okay? So just to try to see if you don't write this one. I told you, if you don't write this one, so actually this one is going to, you are going to have a continuous interrupts. You got what I'm saying? So if you have a task in the main, the task is not going to be run. If you have a task in any other interrupts are not going to be run. What I'm saying, because all the time CPU is going to be here all the time because it's going to have continuous interrupts. That's why I told you it's very, very serious. You have to make sure you clear it. Okay. Anyway, So now I'm going to start explaining what we call SysTick or system tick or system timer, whatever SysTick. I told you, number one, this does not have an external pin. As I told you, it is some kind of, we have CPU here. We have a hardware circuit here. All what is going to happen is CPU is going to program, is going to configure, is going to initial, is going to ask the timer, release timer, count for 10 milliseconds. Every 10 milliseconds, interrupt me. That's it. Okay. And then after this happens, so you have a subroutine. This subroutine is going to be executed every 10 milliseconds, for example. Okay. So actually, this one is used if you wanna do periodic interrupts. Okay. If your task or your programming problem needs to do something periodic, you understand what I'm saying? For example, if you want to do multitasking, something like that, or something, I want to do something periodic, okay? Every sometime I want to do something, okay? So you can use this one. Because as long as the interrupt is enabled, we are going to have periodic interrupts, as you see here. In every interrupt, you are going to execute a subroutine. Every interrupt, you are going to execute the subroutine. Here, there is a certain time. For sure, you can control the time. For example, I can say, please trigger interrupt every 1 second. I'm going to explain how. So once you do that, so the interrupt subroutine is going to be executed every one second. Okay. So here, this system timer is actually, it's a part of the core system. The core system here, it's ARM Core M architecture. So it's a part of the core, we call it core system. Even if I go back, because I told you before, let me go, yeah, here, look here, guys. I told you we have some interrupts. This interrupt is coming from the processor circuit itself, okay? One of them, this one. Yeah, this is the one I'm gonna explain right now, okay? We have another timer. And the other ones here, this is our peripheral. And this peripheral are done by STM32L. Okay, it's a little bit tricky. Look here, we have two things. We have the processor itself. The processor is Cortex-M0 processor. Is that okay? The other processor, this is coming from ARM, okay? But the microcontroller is done by STM32. This is a microcontroller. So what they did, They took the processor and then they added some devices, peripheral to it to create microcontroller. You got what I'm saying? So here, so this one, that's what I'm gonna explain right now. So this ones here, we call them peripheral. This one here is a part of the core system, okay? So I'm gonna explain how it works. How can you program in and so on. So number one, what name I have to use for the subroutine? Yeah, this is the name you have to use. This is the name, SysTick _handler. How you came up with this one? Yeah, similar to, we always do that, right? So if you come here, yeah, this is the name, you have to use this name, okay? So in the future, if I explain, for example, this one, you have to use this name. If I explain this one, you have to use this name. If you explain this one, you have to use, this is not an interrupt. So for example, this one, you have to use this name and so on, okay? So these are the names of all the subroutines or interrupt subroutine. Because I'm programming this one, this is the name you have to use. Okay, that's okay. How it works is, look at the idea. There is something we call hardware counter. I'm not sure if you remember it or if you took it in digital system or not, but anyway, I'm gonna explain how it works. So hardware counter is actually, flip-flops are connected together. Is that okay? So it is hardware circuit. It's a hardware circuit, okay? So this hardware circuit, I'm gonna input clock to this hardware circuit, okay? And this is actually a counter. Some of them can be up counter, up, so you can count up, or some of them can be down counter, can count it down. What it means, I'm gonna tell you, hardware circuit, okay? Even some of them are chip. Anyway, so this hardware circuit, so actually what happens is that for every clock, this counter is gonna be incremented by one, for example. So what happens here, if this one is actually 0000, okay? And again, it's just a number of flip-flops. It's a hardware. Anyway, so if this one is counting up, so every time there is a clock here, every time for this clock, so this one is gonna count up. Now it is one. For another clock, it's gonna be two. It's gonna count binary for sure. It's gonna be two and so on. You get what I'm saying? So we have a counter, hardware counter. This counter needs a clock for every cycle in this clock, every cycle, the count is gonna be incremented by one. Number two, you have to tell me, this counter up or it is down? Okay, this actually, for this one, this is down counter. So it's gonna count down, right? Number three, you have to tell me how many bits is this counter. So this one is 24 bits. Is that okay? So that means you are gonna start from a certain value, okay? And this value is actually 24 bits, and it's gonna count down until zero. Okay, and every clock, every one cycle is gonna decrement by one. So as you see here, for example, if I start with this value, okay? If I start with this value here, as you see. So after one clock, it's gonna be E. After one clock, decrement by one until it comes to here and then comes to zero. Once it comes to zero, it's gonna trigger interrupt. And then the initial value is gonna be loaded again here. Hardware will do that. Let me say it again. For example, so if I put here, guys, for example, number 100. So what's going to happen, 100 is going to be written here. So this one is going to count from 100 until zero. Trigger interrupt. And then this value is going to be initiated again. So after zero, I'm going to go from 100 to zero again. So that means I'm going to get interrupted every 100 count. This is the timeout. Every 100 count, and I know 100 count is gonna take 100 cycle from the clock. Okay, this is the timeout. This is how I can program the timeout. I'm gonna give you more details, but I'm just explaining how it works. See how the hardware circuit works. So the way the hardware circuit works is that if you wanna trigger interrupts every 1 second, I'm gonna give you a mathematical formula. To get a number, what number you have to put here so that you can trigger interrupts every 1 second. I'm gonna tell you how it works. But the main idea is that, let me put this way. You already know, the clock. So the question is that, for one second, how many clocks I need for 1 second? How many clocks? Okay. So for example, if you need 2 million clocks, to make 1 second. So I have to put here 2 million, okay? So the number you have to put here, actually, this is the timeout. The timeout, but not in second, but in number of counts. You understand what I'm saying? For example, I wanna trigger interrupt every 100 counts. So I'm gonna put here 100. And what's gonna happen, I'm gonna tell you for sure what is this register. Once you put here 100, 100 is gonna be written here, and this one is gonna count. Once it is zero, this value is gonna be loaded again, 100, okay? So once you finish counting one, again, CPU is not involved in this. This is hardware, okay, guys? So as you see here, guys, again, you should understand how it works, okay? Because the way you are gonna program it is gonna be consistent with what I'm saying right now. So number one, the idea is that I need to trigger periodic interrupts. Okay, these periodic interrupts are actually every number of counts corresponding to a certain time. I'm gonna give you a formula to do that. For example, if I wanna trigger interrupts every 1 second, so there is some formula is gonna tell you how many counts. How many counts should be done here, okay? In order to make one second, is that okay? Also, we can control the clock. There is some control, the clock source. We have two different clocks. You can control if you want to use this clock or you want to use this clock, as I'm gonna explain. For sure, the timeout depends on two things. Depends on your clock. How fast is your clock? It depends on what is number I'm gonna write here. You understand what I'm saying? So two things. I'm gonna give you more details. But this is the main idea. The The main idea, for example, as you see here, if the initial value is 00F, what's gonna happen is gonna, for every clock, is gonna decrement until it is zero. Once it is zero, it's gonna trigger interrupt as you see here, and then it's gonna be reload again, automatically reload again, okay? To count again from F00 until 000 again, trigger another interrupt and continue doing that. Any questions? So all what you need to do is time out, okay? I need to convert the time out in second or millisecond. I need to convert it to number of counts and then put them here. That's it, okay? And to do that, I'm gonna give you a formula because the clock, I have to consider the clock for sure, okay? Again, every time it's decremented by one, this one needs one clock. Decremented by one, this needs one clock and so on, okay? So for example, I give you example here. So if I put six, if I start from six, so this one is gonna take one clock. It's gonna take one clock here to count from six to five. From five to four is gonna take one clock period. From four to three is gonna take one clock period and so on, okay? And then after zero, there is another clock here. That means if I put six, so actually it's gonna count to seven. There is one more. You understand what I'm saying? That's why I'm telling you, if I want to trigger interrupts every 100 counts, you should not put 100 here. You have to put 100 minus one. You have to put 99. You understand what I'm saying? So yeah. So if I put, as you see here, if I put here number six, so it's gonna take seven. It's gonna take seven until we trigger again. Okay. And so interrupt is gonna be triggered again here, and then after one cycle, we're gonna go again high to six. This is done automatically. You don't need to do anything, okay? And every time you trigger interrupt here, okay? So that means you have to, as I told you, the number, if you wanna trigger interrupt every 100, so you have to put here 99 because always there is one extra, okay? Anyway, so now how can we program it, okay? Or how can we use it, okay? Very easy. This one is much easier than the previous one, okay? How can we use it? Number one, you have for sure to get the reload value. I'm gonna give you a formula to do that. Very simple formula. And then you have to write it here. Yes, for sure. Because this is the time out. Okay, that's okay. Also, as I'm gonna explain right now, the clock. There are two sources of clocks, two sources. You can select one of them. One of them is slower than the other. So it depends on what I'm gonna give you more details. Also, we have this very important register. In this register, we have important bits. So let me go through the bits because that's what we are gonna program. Okay. So let's start with, yeah, this is a very good figure, very, very good figure. So look, let's understand this. We have only one register. I told you programming this one is very trivial, very easy, much easier than the previous one, okay? So let's see here. This is a count flag. So this is actually hand. You know when you raise your hand? So this is actually this one, okay? So this is like the bending, okay? So every time it is zero, as I told you, so here I put some value. This one is gonna count from this value until zero. Once it is zero, two things are gonna happen once it is zero. Number one is gonna be, you are gonna reload the initial value. You are gonna reload it again, and then you are gonna trigger interrupt by putting one here. This is the bending. This is when you raise your, is that okay, guys? Okay. So that's why also we have one bit here to select the clock source. You want to select this clock or this clock? We have two clocks, okay? Two different frequencies, as I'm going to explain to you. We have one bit for the interrupt. You want to enable or disable interrupts. One bit to enable or disable interrupts, okay? We have another bit to enable or disable counting, not interrupts, counting. Do you want the counter to count or not? Counting, big difference between them. So this one, do you want a counting on one or not? You want to trigger interrupts or not? Usually this one, if you don't use this count, okay? So usually you have to make sure people this way to save power. Because keep in mind, even if it counts, but you disable the interrupts. It doesn't do anything. So again, guys, what I'm saying, I want you to understand why you have 2 bits here. Is that this one should be enough? The interrupt one should be enough. The answer is yes, it should be enough. Why? Because if you disable interrupts, okay, so it's gonna count zero, nothing. Count zero, nothing. Count zero, nothing, because there is no interrupt. You get what I'm saying? That's why I'm saying, yes, this one is enough. However, if I don't use the counter, why I lose energy? Why I consume power? You understand what I'm saying? That is why they made this one. They made this one so that if you don't use it, you have to make sure it's not counting, okay? Just to save power. For sure, this one is not as important as this one. For sure, this one is more important. Anyway, this figure, if you understand it, this is the whole story. Very, very interesting, very, very important. Look here, guys. So in order to trigger interrupts, there should be 2 things. Number one, you have to raise your hand, okay? And this happens, as I told you, every time the counter is zero, so one is gonna be put here, okay? So it has to be one. Also, this one, this is the enable for interrupt. This one has to be one. We're gonna do and then by this way, we are gonna trigger interrupts. That means in order to trigger interrupts, 2 things should happen to trigger interrupts. Number one, this bit has to be one to enable the interrupts. Number two, when you raise your hand, so it has to be requesting interrupt. You don't put one here. Who's gonna put one here is a hard way, but you control this one to request interrupt, okay? Very easy, very trivial. That means, because tomorrow we'll do that. That means if I want to enable interrupt, very trivial. All what I have to do, just in this bit, I have to put one. If I want to disable interrupts, all what you have to do, this bit put zero. That's it, very trivial. Just one bit, put one or zero to enable interrupts or disable interrupts. That's it, okay? Anyway, also here, this is the clock for the counter. As you see here, guys, we have 2 sources of clocks. We have the system clock. You have a multiplexer. You can take the system clock or you can take the system clock divided by 8. So you have 2 sources here. Either the system clock, which is actually 2.08 megahertz. So 2.08 megahertz. So this can be, so now we have 2 sources. We have clock with this one here is actually 2.08 megahertz. This one here actually is 2.08 divided by 8 megahertz. So this one is gonna be slower. We have 2 sources, one fast, one slow, 2 different frequencies. And you can select which one you wanna use, okay? So how can you select this bit? Very easy, very trivial. So actually, if you put here in this bit, if you put zero, so you are gonna select this one. We call it external clock. Actually, it's not external, but we just use, because in some of the design, they allow you to input external. It's called external, but actually here in this design, it's not external, okay? But because in a different microcontroller, different numbers, they allow you to input some externals. Well, okay, but anyway, most of them are internal, but actually we are gonna call this one internal, we are gonna call this one external, okay? So here, if you put here zero, so you are gonna connect the slow clock. If you put one here, you are gonna connect the fast clock. Also, this is the enable. Look at this one, very important, this one. Look here, guys. Here, this one is gonna receive a clock this way. And now, if you put here zero, I'm gonna get zero. No counting, it's not gonna count. The counter is not gonna count if there is no clock, hardware, okay? However, if I put one here, so this one is gonna connect it here for counting, okay, guys? So let me tell you the conclusion. The conclusion is that until now, in order to program it, what should I do? Number one, there is one bit, this bit, about the clock, okay? You need to select this clock or this clock, this one here, okay? Number two, you have to enable counting. Number three, you have to enable interrupts from here. That's it, okay? Also, you have to count what number and you have to put the number here. You have to put it only one time. And the reloading is done automatically. You understand what I'm saying? So only one time, you have to put some value in one time. And then every time, this reloading, every time it's gonna be reloaded automatically. Is that okay? And this is the bending bit. This one, is the bending bit. This is when you raise your hand, okay? However, so as based on what I explained to you before, in the interrupt subroutine, you have to clear this one. You have to put zero here in the interrupt subroutine. That's what I explained to you before. However, for this interrupt, you don't need to do that. It is done automatically for you. You get what I'm saying? Because this is a system, it's a system interrupt. So it's done automatically. So in the interrupt subroutine, this is different from what we did before. So what I did before here, guys, as you see, I have to clear the flag bit. Here, you don't need to clear the flag bit, okay? Because this is already done automatically for you. Any questions? Yeah. So here, as I explained, we have here interrupt bit. This one is used to enable or disable interrupts. You have the enable bit. This one is used if you want to enable counting or not. For sure, you have to enable counting because even if you enable interrupts and it is not counting, there are no interrupts. If it's not counting, there are no interrupts because it's not going to come to zero. Okay. Anyway. So also you can select the clock source. I told you we have two sources of clocks. We have this one and we have this one, okay? This one, also I told you, we have 24-bit, we have 24-bit counter, okay guys? So the number you can put here up to 24 bits, okay? So the question is that, so you understand that I need time out every certain time, okay? I need time out every 1 second, for example. There is a formula, I'm gonna give you the formula right now to convert the time in seconds to number of counts. And this is what you have to put here. You have to write a command to put it here in this register. Is that okay? Okay, so now I wanna tell you what is the maximum delay I can get, okay? And what is the minimum, for example? The maximum delay, the minimum is easy, but if you look at what is the maximum delay? The maximum delay for sure, if I put here FFFF 24 means 8 fours, right? 8 or I think less, right? How many ones here? So FFFF 24 divided by 4 should be 6 Fs, right? Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, so this is the maximum delay I can get, the maximum delay, maximum timeout. If you do the calculation, if you do the math, as you see here, guys, so maximum is gonna be 2 to the power 24, whatever this number is, times, this is the time for one clock. So this is the time for one clock, which is 1/frequency. So 1/frequency is gonna give you the time for one clock. Anyway, so if you do the math, that means if you use the internal clock, the maximum delay you can get 8 seconds. So I can do interrupts every 8 seconds. This is the maximum. When you put FFFFF, it's gonna count from FFF from the maximum value until 000. And then from the maximum to 00, maximum to 000. If you do that, actually it's gonna be every 8 seconds, okay? However, if you use the external clock, which is slower, it's slower because you divide by 8, okay? In this case, we can have interrupts every 64 seconds, which is very long time. This is the maximum, okay? For sure, the smallest, you can make only one. Here you can put one count. Make one count here, so this is a range. This is the maximum for one clock, this is the maximum for the other clock. Here, if you count only one count, trigger interrupt. One count trigger. So actually it's gonna be 1/2.08 megahertz, which is around half microsecond. Very interesting. So actually you can make interrupts every half microsecond. For sure, that's too fast. So you can trigger interrupts starting from half microsecond until 8 seconds here in this case. Any questions? Okay, now we have registers. We have a register, we call it system tech load register. This is a register, I told you this is a load register. Yeah, this is a reload register. This is where you have to put number of counts here, the timeout. So you have to put the timeout when you do the any. It's you just do it one time, initialization. So in the initialization, you have to put the timeout here. I'm gonna show, yeah. So this is actually, this one is called system tick load register. All what you have to do, this is the maximum value because this one is 24 bit. So this is the, you cannot put more than this value. This is the maximum 16 million and something, okay? And as I told you guys, if you wanna trigger interrupts every 100 clocks or 100 clock period or 100 counts, it's the same. What, because we count for every one clock period, we count one. Okay. So if you wanna count every 100, you have to put in this one 99 because there is one extra one we do it at the end. Okay. Okay, we have another register. This register is called system tick value. So this one actually is gonna give you the current count. I told you we count from 000 we count from a certain value. For example, if I start from FF00, it's gonna count until 000. So this is the value in the counter itself, the current count. This is the value that changes. So this value is changing, okay? So this is also a register. Someone can ask me, okay, wait a second. I understand why we need this one. Because this is where I can program the time out. If I want to trigger interrupts every 100, so I'm going to put here 100. I understand that. But why I need to access so the counter itself, the value inside the counter itself, why I would need it, okay? Actually, you are gonna need it because in the very beginning, it's gonna have a random value. In the very beginning, I need to put zero because in the very beginning, I have to clear it in the very beginning. You got what I'm saying? So in the very beginning, I have to make sure this one is zero, okay? I have to put some initial value here in this one in the very beginning, okay? Other than that, I don't think, but if you need it, you can know. If you need to know what is the current count, yeah, you can read it from this one, okay? But so in the initialization, we're gonna use this one to make sure we start from a certain value, okay? Now let's come to the formula. I promised you, I told you there is a certain formula. It's a very easy formula, very easy. Look here, guys, this is, so for example, if I wanna make interrupts every 1 second, okay guys, every 1 second. What is the number I have to convert to number of counts, okay? Very easy. So all what I have to do guys, in 1 second, this is 1 second. How many clock cycles are there? How many clock cycles? Is that okay? Because for every clock cycle, we are gonna count by one. So, and this is the number I will get. And this is exactly what I did. As you see here guys, this is the number I got. I have to divide 1 second divided by the clock period, the period of the clock. And don't forget, I have to subtract one. Because I told you, if you wanna count 100, or if your time out is 100, you have to put 99, okay? Anyway, and then this one becomes, this is the value, so you have to multiply 1 second times clock frequency, minus one. Very easy, very trivial. So all what you have to do, guys, is that. Okay, this is the time out. This is whatever it is. In this example, I'm giving you 1 second as an example. If you wanna make it 2 seconds, 3 seconds, 1 millisecond, 20 millisecond, whatever it is, okay? So you just put the number in, this is the time out, times the clock frequency minus one, okay? Someone can ask me, what is the clock frequency? Actually, as I have told you, the clock frequency can be one of two things. It can be 2.08 megahertz, or it can be 2.08 megahertz divided by 8. This is where you have one bit. There is one bit here. You can select from this bit. Do you want an internal or external? You remember here? Yeah. So you have two clock cycles. So you have this bit can determine, are you gonna use, if I put here, as you see here, if I put one, so actually clock is going to be 2.08 megahertz. But if you put zero, actually the clock is going to be 2.08 megahertz divided by 8. You got what I'm saying? But for example, if here in this example, I'm considering zero, if you put zero, okay? So this one should be 2.08. So if you do the calculation, you will find you will find in order to trigger interrupts every 1 second, I have to use this number. I think in tomorrow's lab, I asked you for 1 second, half a second, and 2 seconds, right? So yeah, so all what you have to do in this half a second is gonna be, you can do the calculation again. By the way, even if you make a mistake, because you know, everyone actually half microsecond. So even if you make a mistake, you are not gonna feel it. So if you have 1 second minus half microsecond, you think you're gonna feel it? You're not gonna feel it because it's, you got what I'm saying? But anyway, but this is very accurate. You wanna do it, it's gonna be very accurate. Anyway, so because every one count is gonna be 1/2.8 meters, half microsecond. You're not gonna feel it anyway. But anyway, so this is, so for tomorrow, so that means roughly, if I wanna make interrupts every half a second, you can just divide this one by 2 and get the closest number. You are not gonna feel it. If it is one microsecond more or 2 microseconds more, you are not gonna feel it, okay? It should be okay. Also, if you wanna make it like multiplied by 2, if you wanna trigger interrupts, but you have to be careful. You have maximum, this is the maximum. Whatever the number you are gonna use, you should not exceed this number. As I explained before, you have a maximum. Because this one is 24 bits. Okay, guys. Now, like any interrupt, how can you enable the interrupt? Okay. So again, we have 1 bit here for enable or disable. Very easy, very trivial. So if you wanna enable interrupts, always you have to use this one for enable. If you wanna disable, you can just use this. You can use this one for disable. Okay. Again, we have some constant values already defined in your project. So instead of saying one shifted one, because here, this one here. So it's gonna be one shifted one time so that the one becomes here, okay? Again, I prefer it should be used this one, but again, I'm saying you can use this one or we have some constant values you can already defined in your project. You can use it, whatever you want, but I like this one because just I can understand what I'm doing here exactly. So again, the conclusion is that if you wanna enable the periodic interrupts, that's what you have to use. Okay, you have to put here one. If you wanna disable, you have to use this one. Okay, guys? Okay, when I need to enable or disable, I'm gonna tell you because that's what we need to do later, tomorrow also, and also in test 2. Assume this timer or periodic interrupts in the coming example is doing flashing. You turn on and turn off. So it's doing some test, a test. And I don't want to do this test at a certain point of my system, or I don't want to do this test. Just disable it. Very simple. For any interrupt source, guys, every interrupt is doing a test. At any moment, if you don't want to do this test, just disable the interrupt. So if we do flashing LED, using this one, and you don't want to do flashing, just disable this interrupt. You are not gonna. If you wanna resume flashing again, just enable. In general, if an interrupt source is doing a test, you don't want to do the test, just disable. If you wanna resume it, if you wanna do the test again, just enable. That's it. That's what I'm saying. Here, I don't need. There are two big differences between this one and what I explained to you before for external interrupt. The first difference, we don't have enable bit here. Okay, and this is an exception only for this one because this is like a core system interrupt. It's not a peripheral interrupt. Number two, again, you don't need to clear the flag bit. This is done automatically. You don't need to clear the flag bit. For any other interrupt source, you need to clear the flag bit as we did before. Also, you need to enable the bit here. There is 1 bit in this one. Okay, guys. Okay. Now, also you need to do configuration similar to what for any interrupt you need to do configuration. What kind of configuration I have to do here? Number one, you have to make sure you enable counting. How can you enable counting? As I said, all what I have to do to enable counting, I have to make sure I put one here. Okay, and that's what I did. So in the initialization, I have to make sure you enable counting. Is that okay? Number two, you have to select the clock source. Okay, so you have to use either this one or this one for internal, this one for external, okay? So actually what you are doing here one or zero in this pin, easy, one or zero, okay? Number three, I have to set the timeout. In order to set the timeout, okay, I have to, as you see here, guys, I have to do two things in the initialization. How many number if interrupts you want to make -1, okay, that's what I'm saying, ticks -1. So if I want to make 100 interrupts, so here I have to put 99, I have to put it in this register, okay? Also, don't forget to start from zero. Otherwise, in the very beginning, the first one, it may not be, the timeout may be shorter or longer. So you have to start from zero so that the first one is going to be exactly the same value. If the timeout 2 milliseconds, so the first one is going to be 2 milliseconds because I'm going to start from zero. So reloading is going to happen right away. Any questions? Okay. For similar to any interrupt source, for the function, this is the name of the function you have to use. For the binding bit, as I told you, this is done automatically. You don't need to clear the binding. There is something here tricky. Actually, and the TA told me 3 students contacted him about it, and I already put it here in the slides, as you see. So actually, if you define this function in your program, you are going to receive error. The error is telling you this function has been defined before. Double definition is not allowed. You cannot define the same function twice. You cannot do that. You get what I'm saying? But you didn't define it before. Yes, you didn't. However, in the project you have, it's already defined under this one. So all what you have to do, guys, you have to make sure you have to go here to this file. You have to comment this one. You have to comment this one so that you can write this one in your main. Okay, so this one you are gonna write it in your main. Or I think this is the best way. Or you can just write, you keep this one and write your program here. But I don't prefer this solution. So in my, it's better, you have to make sure you comment this one. Again, if the compiler tells you double definite something in the meaning of you cannot define a function twice, so that's because this one is defined. You have to make sure you comment. Any questions? So now, look here, guys. If you go chapter 3, in the first program I taught in chapter 3, how to make a flashing LED, okay? Flashing LED. If you remember the way I did it, you have to turn LED on. Then you remember when I called the delay, function called the delay 1000 to count for one second to delay, and then turn LED off. And then you have to delay 1000 and keep repeating. That's what we did in chapter 3. The first program I taught in chapter 3 was how can you do flash? Okay, so what we did, turn the LED on, call the function to wait for 1 second, turn it off, call the function to wait 1 second, and then repeat again. Is that okay? Very important. I'm gonna keep repeating it. Very important, you should understand. This is a task. For example, I want to do flashing. This is a task. This task, as I said before, your program is not going to be written in one place anymore. Your program is going to have multiple tasks. Is that okay? And you need to decide. For example, I have the main function. Also, I have interrupt, for example, external interrupt. I have system. I have a timer interrupt. So I have several interrupts. Okay? So this is a design. So now you need to decide. Okay, I wanna do, so you can here put one task here. Task one, you can put it here. Task two, you can put it here. Task three, you can put, task four, you can put it here, and so on. You got what I'm saying? So everyone is gonna do one task. So what I did in chapter 3, I did the flashing and I put it in the main. I wanna link what I'm gonna teach right now with what I did in chapter 3. I did flashing by putting the code in main. So main is gonna take care of flashing. What I'm gonna do right now is I want a system tick to take care of flashing. So exactly the same thing I did in chapter 3. I'm going to repeat it right now, but instead of putting the task in the main, I'm going to put it here in the interrupt, in this interrupt. Is that okay? You understand what I'm saying? Okay. So how can you do it? So again, what I did in chapter 3, I'm going to repeat it, but instead of doing flashing in the main, I'm going to do flashing here in system in this one. How can you do it? Okay, very simple. All you want to do flashing. Is that okay? All what I'm going to do, guys, number one, I'm going to configure the timer to trigger interrupts every 1 second because I want to do flashing every 1 second. Okay? By doing that, I can guarantee there are interrupts every 1 second. I guarantee there is a subroutine. This subroutine is going to be executed every 1 second. Make sense? Okay. All what I'm going to do, write here in the subroutine, flip LED. Can it be easier? Very trivial. So comparing to what I did, I want you to compare what I'm going to do here with what I did in chapter 3. Here, what I did, only I'm going to write only one instruction. For sure, I'm going to do some initialization. Sure. After the initial, forget the initialization. After the initialization, in order to do flashing, I'm going to only write one instruction here, flip LED. It's much, much easier than what I did in chapter 3. Why? Because most of the work is done by the hardware. Counting for 1 second is done by the hardware. I don't need to write a code to count for 1 second. That is why I'm going to take a very little time from the CPU. All what the CPU is going to do, every 1 second, CPU, please go execute this one, flip LED. That's it. I'm going to take very little time from the CPU. And this is a beauty. Why it's a beauty? Because CPU can do a lot of things. Just it one task, because the hardware did most of the work here, counted for 1 second, it's done by the hardware. Okay? Anyway, So again, that's all what I'm going to do. So here, guys, because I'm going to use one LED, I have to initialize the LED as we did before. Now I'm going to create a function. This function is called initialization for system ticker. Okay. So, and then I have to send some value. This is the timeout, the timeout. And as I told you before, we have how we can come up with this value. Okay. So if I come here, guys, this is the initialization. How I did the initialization? Exactly same thing as I explained before. Number one, here you are going to say send count here, number of count. Okay, so I'm going to decrement to one. So if you want to trigger interrupts every 100 counts, okay, so I'm going to put in 99. So I'm going to put 99 in the load register. I already explained what is the load register. Okay, so I'm going to count from 99 to 0, then 99 to 0. 99 to 0, 99 to 0. Every time the counter is 0, the hardware is going to put 99, whatever written here. Also, I have to make sure the counter starts from 0 so that the first one has to be 99. Okay. Also, I have to select the clock. So here I have to select the clock has to be internal. Very easy. Okay. It's a good thing, guys. Every time you want to use the timer, that's what you have to do. Maybe you can do some little changes, but this is the steps you have to do. Little changes like what? For example, here I'm using internal. Maybe you want to use external clock. So instead of using this one, you can use a different number as I explained to you before, okay? You have to enable counters. So all the time you have to enable counters. You have to enable interrupts. That's it. That's it. That's all what I have to do. Very simple, very easy, okay? So once you do that, once you call this subroutine, now I have periodic interrupts every 1 second. I have a subroutine that's going to be called every 1 second. Where is this subroutine? This is the subroutine. This subroutine is going to be called every 1 second. So all what I'm going to do, flip LED. Very interesting, very easy. Any questions? You got what I'm saying? So keep in mind, once I do the initialization, so every 1 second, this subroutine is going to be executed. And then write whatever you want to write here. What do you want to do every 1 second? For sure, that's a very simple program. What do you want to do every 1 second? What I'm saying? Okay, so if I want to do it every half second, okay, same thing, but I'm gonna be to a different number. Just a different number. Okay. You have the programs, you have everything, you have the board, you can just try it, okay? Now, because this is important for tomorrow, what I'm gonna do right now, guys, look here. What I'm gonna do is exactly the same program I have to write it. So if you run this program, you are gonna see flashing on for 1 second, off for 1 second, on for 1 second, off for 1 second. Is that okay? And as you see here, the main program is empty. The main program is empty. The main is empty. So you can put a task here. Yeah, you can put another task here. You can put, and that's what I'm asking you to do tomorrow. Okay, because I want you to see, because this is the most important thing, that by using interrupters, we can run multiple tasks at the same time. If you don't understand that, it's gonna be too bad, for sure. You're not gonna understand why interrupts are so important. You know what I'm saying? That's why in tomorrow, and also in the test, I'm gonna make it intentionally. I'm gonna put different tasks to understand how the processor can run multiple tasks at the same time. Okay, very important. So tomorrow, I asked you to put here a task, okay? So that means you can put here a task, and then every 1 second, the processor is gonna go to the subroutine and execute this one and come back. So most of the time the processor is here, and then every interrupt is gonna go and come back, okay? Every 1 second, okay? So what you should feel, you are gonna feel like everything is running at the same time. You are not gonna feel that this test is suspended, okay? Unless, for sure you can feel it. You can feel there is suspension, for sure. If you have too many interrupters, because we have a capacity, we don't do much, we have a capacity, okay? We have a certain speed. Also, or if you write too much code here, that's why if you write too much code here. By the way, I saw in the past some student make here delay, they call up the function delay to make 1 second, to make a delay for 1 second. You got what I'm saying? For sure, they don't understand the concept of interrupt. That count for 1 second is not gonna be done by the CPU. It's not gonna be done here. It's already done by the hardware. It's done for you by the hardware. So you don't need to count for 1 second. Some student did it, so that's not bad. That's so bad, anyway. So now what I'm gonna do right now, guys, I just wanna modify it. So now if you run this program, you can see flashing, right? I wanna just modify this program to add external interrupt. So that every time you press the button, you are gonna call external interrupt number 5. And here, if flashing is on, I'm gonna make it off. If flashing is off, I'm gonna make it on. Interrupt, you got what I'm saying? By this way, I have flashing, you have flashing. Once I press the button, no flashing. You press the button, it's gonna flash, okay? I think I have the video, but maybe. Yeah, just maybe it's better if you can see the video here. I think this one. Okay. Look here, guys, it's flashing. Once I press the button, what I did when I press the button, number one, who's doing flashing? Timer. The timer is doing the flashing, okay? When I press the button, so I'm gonna trigger external interrupt. In the external interrupt, I'm gonna say disable the interrupters of timer. Because you disable it, you're not gonna see flashing anymore. Because who's doing flashing? The timer. So if the timer is disabled, you're not gonna call the subroutine again to do flashing, right? When I press again, so I enable interrupts, it's working again. That I'm saying. So anyway. So here, okay, how can you do that? Number one, very easy, very easy. All what I'm gonna do, guys, similar, I'm gonna just merge this program, exactly same program I have right now. I'm gonna add the program I took before in external 5. So I'm gonna just here, I'm gonna call this function to do initialization. And then in the interrupt subroutine, I'm gonna say, if the timer is enabled, make it disabled. If disabled, make it enabled. Is that okay? Anyway, so here, that's exactly what I did. So this is just a simple modification. So what I did here, guys, is that it's exactly the same program I took before. All what I added here, guys, as you see, all what I added this one here, okay? I added this one because I'm gonna use BA5 for external interrupts, okay? And then I added, this is the external interrupts are here, okay? So all what I did here, guys, as you see, I added only this one. That's all what I added. Look what I did, what this one is doing. Very serious, what this one is doing. What this one is doing, as you see here, bit number one. I'm gonna flip bit number one in this register. I'm gonna flip bit number one in this register. And if I go back and see what is bit number one for the first bit here, the first bit here is actually, I think it worked, but I should, which one I have to flip? I have to flip this one, is that right? I have to flip this one. But actually what I did, I flipped this one. So I stopped, I don't think it's, yeah. So all what I did, I flipped this one. It's gonna work because it's not counting, but I think that's not the proper way. So yes, it's gonna work because if it doesn't count, there are no interrupts. Good, I'm saying, I think the right way to do it, I'm gonna fix it. All what you have to do, guys, here, just flip the second bit here. So all what you have to do is that, it's a mistake from me, so but we can fix it simply. So here, all what you have to do, instead of writing one, you have to write two. That's it. Because when I wrote one, it's not counting. It's because it's not counting, no interrupts. You get what I'm saying? Anyway, I don't, that's okay. If you wanna, still okay. But you know, I prefer to just to do it in by bit number two interrupts. Anyway, okay, guys? And then everything else is the same. I just added this one. Tomorrow's lab. What you have to do tomorrow, guys? I know. I don't give you enough time to labs. That's why labs are easy. Just you start from this program, right? Number one, you have to run this program. You have to make sure this program is working. You have to see there is flashing. Is that okay? And then every time you press a button, no flashing. That's what you have to see. Okay. Then I asked you to do some very little modification on this program. Okay. So I think as far as I remember, I asked you to do several tasks. For example, if the program or status. If you are in status one, status one, I think you have to run, the delay should be 1/2 second, right? And status two should be 1 second. If the program is in status three, it should be 2 seconds. And if this is status four, and status four should be actually off, no flashing, I guess, as far as I remember, okay? So what should happen here, guys, is that I give you a lot of hint. Number one, every time you press, number one, you need a variable, you need a global variable. I'm gonna call it, for example, status, to know if this is status one or two or three or four, okay? So, and when I say global, and maybe this is very important, you should not define it here in the main. Global, it should be outside the main. So if you define it inside the main here, so it's gonna be used inside the main. But here this is outside the main. So you have to define it here. So you have to define the variable here outside the main to be global, okay? And then all what I'm gonna do every time this one is interrupted. So all what you have to do is just to change this one, that's it. So all what you have to do, guys, every time you press the button, so actually you are gonna increment status. So you're gonna say status plus plus. You have to increment status, okay? Also, you have to see if status is equal to 5, you have to check. If status is equal to 5, then status has to be 1, because after 4, it has to be 1. Make sense? So number one, every time I press the button, you have to increment status. Okay, because I want to move from one status to next. And then number two, status, if I'm already at 5 and I want to increase at 4, then I release the button and then increment it becomes 5. Before it's 5, I have to go back to 180. Okay, this is number one. Number two, that's what you have to done here. You have to do it here. Very simple. So after that, this now, if the status is equal one, I have to make sure the flashing should be every 1/2 second. Okay, if flashing equal to, if status equal to, I have to make sure flashing is equal, is every 1 second. Okay, if three, I have to make sure if it is 2 seconds. If it is four, you have to make sure it is off. Okay. And also it is not written, but if it is 1, 2, 3, that means flashing has to be on, right? So the timer has to, the interrupt system has to be on. So if it's 4, in order to make no flashing, so I'm gonna disable interrupts, the timer interrupts. But here, I have to make sure the timer interrupts are enabled. Okay. So all what I need to know, all what I need to do, guys, number one, I need to disable interrupts. Timer interrupts. Here I have to enable timer interrupts. How can you do that? I have just explained here. I'm going to go back to show you where I told you, where I told you you can enable or disable interrupts. Yeah, here. If you see here, guys, this one can be used to enable. If you want to enable interrupts, you can use this one. If you want to disable interrupts, you can just use this one. That's easy. Okay. Number two, what else do you need to make in tomorrow's lab? Okay. What I need to make is half a second, 1 second, 2 seconds. Okay. You have two options. One option, you can call the initialization again. You can call the initialization again with the number. You have to change the number. So this number is okay for 1 second. So if you want to make 1 second, you can use this number. Okay. Or for sure, if you want to make half a second, so it has to be this number divided by 2. If you want to make it 2 seconds, so this number times 2. Okay. So yes. All what you have to do, you can just call this initialization again with the number, okay, the whole initialization, or you don't need to call the whole initial. You don't need to do all of that, by the way, if you want to be more efficient. So if you want to do like more professional, more efficient, so actually, do I need to do all of that? No, I don't, okay? Actually, all what I need to do is actually, I need these two. That's it. So because I don't need to reconfigure the clock again, okay? Because I'm not gonna change the clock. So just it's repeat, I don't need to do it, okay? But again, I need to make sure it is, I need to make sure interrupt is enabled. So actually all what I need is just this one and this one, okay? So I have to make sure here in this part, I have to make sure interrupt is enabled. So I'm gonna use this one, okay? Again, if you wanna call the whole function, it's okay. But actually, you don't need to this one or you don't need this one. If you just, it's not gonna take much time, it's okay. Any questions? Okay, guys. Very important as a last thing, because again, all what you have to do, guys, I already explained, did all my best to explain it. You have very detailed slides. All what you need to know now to do. Number one, you have to understand this program very well, okay? Very, very well. Number two, you have to modify it, okay? More importantly, you should understand the concept. You should understand why I put this instruction here. Why? Because if you don't understand why, if you need to modify it, you're not gonna be able to do it because you don't understand why I used it, okay? The worst thing you can do just to copy and paste. That is gonna work, you are gonna be happy. Okay, but when you try to modify it, you are not gonna do it, okay? One more thing important, you have to do tomorrow's lab, you have to understand it because in the coming test two is gonna be, you are gonna also use this one as a template to start from this one. So also this one, so if you can do this one, or if you can do tomorrow's lab, you understand it, test two is gonna be easy for you, okay? Also, before, just 1 second, one more thing in tomorrow's lab, guys, as I told you, you are gonna put a task here. This task is actually the previous lab, LCD and the LCD and the keypad, okay? By doing that, listen to me, by doing that, now my program has 3 tasks. One task, LCD and the keypad, and this is done in the mail, okay? Another task, to take care of the status, and this is done by external 5. And another task, which is flashing, this one is done by system tick, okay? So now you have three different tasks, and these tasks are run at the same time. You understand what I'm saying? You should not feel so, and you should feel like everything is running, there is no disruption. Actually, there should be disruption. Because you suspend, what happens when there is an interrupt, you suspend this program and come here, right? You suspend it. But if you do everything very quickly, you are gonna feel everything is running, there is no suspension. You didn't suspend anything, okay? Anyway, and this is the beauty of interrupts. Again, this is very important, guys, to understand. We use interrupts so that we can run multiple tasks. These tasks are not gonna be written in one place anymore, but it's gonna be programmed. And that's exactly what you are gonna do in test two. Test two is the same thing. I'm gonna give you three tasks. And then I'm gonna tell you this task you have to do in the main. This task you have to do in this interrupt. This task you have to do in the interrupt. By this way, you can run multiple tasks at the same time, okay? And because the processor is fast, you should not feel anything is suspended. You can see flashing is working very well. LCD is working very well. The keypad is working very well. Everything is working very well, okay? You shouldn't feel suspicious. Okay, anyway. Okay, see you tomorrow.